My name is Shannon Kasperbauer, and I'm one of the co-chairs of this program, and I'm very excited to see all the familiar faces here today. I'd like to introduce our next speaker, who is Dr. Jakko van Ingen. He is a resident in clinical microbiology at the Radboud University Medical Center in Nijmegen, Netherlands. He has published over 100 articles and 8 book chapters on mycobacterial diseases, and we're very honored to have him here today to talk about Beyond Skinny Ladies.
Well, thanks a lot for a sort of humbling introduction. So, yeah, indeed, my name is Jakko van Ingen from the Netherlands, so I have to start off by saying sorry for 3 things. The first is the funny accent. The second is that I'm sort of allergic to wearing suits. Bear with me there. And they're kind of lumpy to bring on an airplane as well. And the third one is that, like some other folks here, I actually have a sort of financial disclosure, and I'm very happy to be involved in what is finally, perhaps, a new treatment modality for NTM pulmonary disease. So we are working with the Insmed company. My lab is one of their trial labs, and we're also a study site for the trials. So I must say I was a bit scared, because the title of the talk, I was given that title, I didn't make it up myself, was Beyond Skinny Ladies. Now, to me, because I'm not that good in English, that suggested that our situation was like way beyond, you know, oh, we've had that, we've come way beyond. Whereas I think the situation is the reverse. In a lot of countries in Europe, the situation regarding NTM pulmonary disease is closer to what it was in the United States in the 1970s and 80s than it is what it is today. If we would have a patient meeting in the Netherlands and we would try and invite women with nodular bronchiectatic MAC disease, we could do it that in my house, because that would only have 6 people. So that's why the first take-home message really is NTM pulmonary disease manifestations differ in different regions. So the type of NTM pulmonary disease you see is by and large determined by where you are and where you work. And that also goes for the bacteria. Even the causative agents of this terrible disease differ by region. We don't know why, but it's just the case. And I will show you some data to support that. And then even if we think, like Richard already alluded to, if we think we see the same species, it behaves different in different regions. So I thought I should start off with like a pictorial guide to NTM pulmonary disease in the Netherlands. These are just CT images from some of the patients that we recently had admitted. And as you can see, we had one man with nodular bronchiectatic disease, and the rest are all men and women with severe fibrocavitary disease. Big lesions in their lungs, big holes with a lot of inflammation around. And I actually asked one of the patients, like, would you be okay if I show a picture of you? Because I hate looking at these pictures, since these pictures are far more important. This is the kind of patients that I see. Men, usually around the age of 60, with a history of smoking or occupational, things like having been a miner. We had coal mines in the Netherlands up to the 1980s, or working with sand products, so people with silicosis. And so this is our typical patient. So it's not a skinny lady. Sorry. Sadly, typically, they are skinny men, and they are skinny. They haven't been skinny all their life. They're skinny because they have terrible COPD. They have terrible NTM pulmonary disease. So, like Mike Heisman alluded to, they are being consumed. They have consumption, sort of. So Fred here, I asked him, like, could we do a video that you speak to the people here? But then he does not speak English, which also is typical for the patient group that we see. I mean, most folks in the Netherlands do speak English, but hardly any of our patients do. So that tells you a little bit about their background, educational background. But he has terrible mycobacterium xenopi disease. So again, something that's not too prevalent here. And sadly, in our situation, it's quite prevalent and virtually incurable. So a couple of years ago, I did a very basic thing. I just looked at, okay, what patients have we seen who had positive cultures for NTM in my region? So we have like four training hospitals that are under central command, I would say, from our university medical center. So we asked all the labs, okay, which patients did you have NTM isolated from? And we ended up with having over 200 patients with NTM isolated from pulmonary specimens and applying diagnostic criteria. Some 53 of them had definite NTM pulmonary disease. And that cohort was, well, still what we think we mostly see today. 70% were males, the mean age was 57 years old, 3/4 of them had pre-existing pulmonary disease, by and large COPD, and 2/3 of them were still active smokers at the time of diagnosis. Whereas if you walk the streets in my town, you don't see a lot of people smoking. So that again tells you this is a very particular subpopulation. And sadly, 80% of them had severe fibrocavitary disease. And just very few had nodular bronchiectatic disease. And we looked at our own treatment results, and we consider ourselves a reference center. So it's kind of shocking to see that for some, like for MAC pulmonary disease, only 50% of the patients that we had on treatment converted to negative cultures and remained culture negative for quite some time. So it's pretty saddening, really. And one of the other observations we made, and that's something that we then pursued, and that's actually one of the key points that I really want to drive home today, is that we saw that the species that we isolated from respiratory specimens mattered a great deal for diagnostics. Because we saw that some species, I mean, if we found Mycobacterium cansasii, virtually all of the patients that we found it from had definite NTM pulmonary disease. Whereas for a lot of other species that we found, none of the patients had pulmonary disease. They were just like one or two positive cultures, no changes in radiography, no changes in clinical status, and they came and went, nothing happened. But some species clearly cause disease and some clearly don't. So that clinical relevance, as we call it, differs by species. So some species are probably better at causing disease than others. What we also found is that over the time of that study, we saw more and more new patients coming in. And what we saw is that it was predominantly MAC. We saw more and more MAC. A lot of the other species, you know, they are sort of stable in their number of patients every year, but it was the MAC group that grew. So then we saw, okay, what we see here is so mostly fibrocavitary MAC disease or NTM pulmonary disease. And if you, we then looked into the papers and we thought, yeah, you know, if you look at the literature, this is the typical clinical picture that's being described, a typical epidemiology, mostly males, middle-aged, pre-existing pulmonary disease. The clinical course resembles TB, pulmonary TB, but it's slower in its nature. And microbiologically speaking, these patients are easier to diagnose because many of them are smear positive, and it's usually quite easy to get positive cultures out of them. And the radiology, well, of course, speaks for itself, and that's what it do. The name is derived from. So we were like, okay, yeah, this meets a classical picture. And then the funny thing was, we submitted the paper to an American journal that Chuck Daly was an editor of at the time. We got a very nice response back, because all reviewers said, this is nonsense. this is totally untrue, and that was literally in there. This is untrue because this is not what we see in our clinical practice. It was in there. And we were like, what? Untrue? I would not dare go back to a single patient and tell them, oh, the other side of the ocean, they think what you have is not true. No, but we were literally in shock, serious. I mean, and at that time we realized, okay, our situation apparently is very different. And most of the studies have been done by, well, many of the great, great people that are here, people, well, like Mike Heisman, like Richard Wallace, like Chuck Daly, you know, people have really formed this field, but seeing a quite distinct patient group, and if I look around here, I see the difference. Yeah, so. But I still think that we were not untrue at the time. But it did spark a lot of other studies because we were like, wow, how can our situation be that different? You know, what's wrong with us? And so we asked the National Reference Lab to look at this at a national level. And so I went to work with them for a while, and we saw that it was at least not a regional thing. Our entire country saw a rise in the number of MAC isolates being reported, all from pulmonary specimens, all from patients over 40, mostly over 60. And if we got back to the medical records, many of them had pre-existing pulmonary disease. And then we checked our microbiology data with our national registries on COPD prevalence, and they are uncannily similar. So we see more and more MAC, and our national registries see more and more and more COPD. So we think that there's an important link there. But in clinical practice, we now think we see a change coming. We see more and more female patients in our reference clinic. So I actually have a student working on trying to, again, describe the patient cohort that we see. And, well, she said, yeah, absolutely. You know, men only make up half the population. But if you look, the difference is still that we see mostly fibrocavitary disease, except that we now see it a lot in women. Because, well, over the past decades, a lot of women have been smokers in the Netherlands. They really picked up on smoking, which is now, fortunately, getting better. I mean, fewer and fewer people smoke, but so, even though we see more women coming into our reference clinic, we still see very few patients with nodular bronchiectatic disease. It's just that the women also have fibrocavitary disease. And, well, one of the things that worries us in particular about our local epidemiology is that this fibrocavitary disease has such poor treatment outcomes. And, well, for MAC, it's quite good. We have some species like Mycobacterium malmoense, which is very particular to where we are in Europe. That's, if we find that, we cheer, because we know those patients tend to do quite well on the treatment that's identical to MAC, pulmonary disease treatment. But we also see a lot of patients with Mycobacterium xenopi, virtually incurable. Mycobacterium abscessus, very complicated. So, no, we still struggle with that. We see a group that's quite hard to treat. And we know from previous studies and from some literature reviews we've done ourselves that fibrocavitary disease is actually a risk factor for treatment failure. So we see a different group of patients with a different disease and different treatment outcomes. And as I alluded to at the start, we see different NTM species from what we see in the literature reports from North America. MAC predominates, and we studied this in a large international study that fortunately many of the researchers present here were involved in. So MAC predominates virtually worldwide, but then all the other species and how frequent they are in respiratory samples is really dependent on where you are. Like, in most of the world, you know, the rapid growers make up some 20% of all the NTM isolated from respiratory specimens. But if you go into East Asia, Taiwan, Korea, there are quite a large proportion of them are rapid growers, and a lot of it is Mycobacterium abscessus. In Europe, in some hotspots, we see a lot of Mycobacterium xenopi. In Canada, there are some spots where there's a lot of Mycobacterium xenopi, for reasons unknown. In northwestern Europe, not in southwestern Europe, not in northeastern Europe, we see Mycobacterium malmoense. We don't know why. We've never been able to culture it from any environmental sample, but we see it in patients. And it's just in the Netherlands, some parts of the UK, Scandinavia, some in Belgium, and some in Germany, and that's it. And then during the study, we found out there's a hotspot in South Africa where there's a lot of malmoense. I just don't understand why. So apparently where you are determines which NTM you are exposed to. And so one of the things mentioned this morning was the presence of MAC or MAC species in tap and shower water. If you fear that, come live in the Netherlands. Serious, we have no MAC in our water. We've been searching for it for years. We've published, I think, 3 reports on it now. There's a 4th one coming. There is no MAC in our water. We don't know why. It's just not there. Yeah, MAC is the predominant group of species that causes NTM pulmonary disease in my country. So where does it come from? Perhaps it's the same as the chimera story. No, we just don't know where it comes from, but it comes from somewhere. Now, if you look into Europe, and I will not detail on that a lot, as I mentioned, every country, and we are all tiny countries. I think Netherlands is sort of a mid-sized American town. So, and yet, if you go to Belgium, south of us, which is even smaller, totally different NTM species. The whole species distribution, way different. Whereas their geography is not that different. So the climate is the same, you can imagine. I mean, if you drive from here out to Castle Rock, climate's not that different, right? So we don't know why, but there's massive differences in the species that are around. And then we're like, okay, so we see different species, so what? You know, we can still learn from literature, like, okay, if you find intracellulare, it's pretty bad. And if you find Mycobacterium chimera, like Richard Wallace mentioned this morning, not too bad. Well, sorry, Richard. Virtually all of the slides that I showed you in the pictorial guide, virtually all of that is Mycobacterium chimera, severe fibrocavitary disease. So in our Mycobacterium chimeras are definitely not sort of the friendly folks in the MAC group. Definitely not, causes severe disease. There are apparently intrinsic differences in NTM species. We label them by one name, but they differ in their behaviors. So we did a very simple comparison, again, with Won Jun Ko from South Korea, whom I think we should all be very thankful to. He's worked incredibly hard on NTM disease and published really fantastic stuff. And so we compared our national data with his national data, and then looked at, you know, how many isolates did we find, how many of them were actually causing real disease. And at first it looked sort of similar. And then there were really strange differences. Like as I mentioned, if we find Mycobacterium cansasii, that's usually in patients who have fibrocavitary disease. And we hardly ever find a Mycobacterium cansasii isolate in a patient as like a singleton, just a one-off positive culture and then no disease. In South Korea, the reverse is true. Most of their Mycobacterium cansasii isolates are just single positive cultures in patients who have no real disease, no changes in radiology or, well, just, you know, radiology or new symptoms, nothing. So how can that be? You know, we label something by the same name. If you go into the literature, you're like, oh, cansasii is a serious pathogen. But many of the cansasii isolates in South Korea are not linked to disease. So do they have different consortiis? We don't know. And the same thing is for my, I must say, beloved Mycobacterium malmoense, because, well, I was in Copenhagen a while ago, and I actually had to cross the bridge, because Malmo, where the bacterium is named after, is a bridge away from Copenhagen. So I was really tempted to just cross the bridge to have been in Malmo. But I've been chatting too long with some folks present here, so I didn't make it to Malmo. But this is a fascinating book. We see quite a number of patients with Mycobacterium malmoense, fibrocavitary pulmonary disease. And we reported on them a while ago. And then while doing the report, we were looking into the data from the USA collected by CDC. And there actually was a nice study that showed that they had 58 patients with positive cultures from sputum and BAL with Mycobacterium malmoense. Most of it was from Florida. We always thought malmoense was like a cold, close to Arctic thing, but it's present in Florida and in Texas. Well, I was in Texas a couple of days ago. It was not that Arctic, I was. And but the funny thing was, of the many patients they had, 58 patients, only 4 had definite Mycobacterium malmoense pulmonary disease. And the upper chest x-ray is from one of the patients. It was presented in the paper, so it's classic fibrocavitary disease. So only 7% of all the isolates, or all the patients with positive cultures, actually had disease. In our country, virtually all the isolates are from patients who have definite disease. So we looked into 40 patients with positive cultures, and 32 of them had definite disease. The other 8, we could not label them as having definite disease because people only took 1 sputum culture. And that was it. But they had definite radiological disease. So we thought this is like an obligate pathogen. But in the US, apparently it's not. So we're currently working with the team at National Jewish Health, collecting isolates of Mycobacterium malmoense from various parts of the world and do whole genomic sequencing to see, is that one name that we give to these bugs really, you know, does it make sense? Or are they, in fact, quite different? And does that explain why they behave so differently, depending on where you are? So I will leave you with that. I hope that by now you realize that we are not beyond what's going on here in Europe. We're sort of trying to get up to the same level. But we see different NTM pulmonary disease manifestations in different patient groups, caused sometimes by the same species, but oftentimes by different species that are particular to our local situation. And that particular local situation cannot be extrapolated to anywhere, because even the species may be found elsewhere but behave differently elsewhere. So my personal quests, I thought I have to mention that to you, not to think that after this talk I'm done. I'm like, okay, put the word out and now I can just lay back. I will work on this some more. And one of the things we are looking into is, are these 3 take-home messages somehow related? So are the bacteria perhaps different where I live? And is that the reason that they cause a particular type of NTM pulmonary disease in a particular group of patients? So we're also doing immunological studies of our patients at this moment, and we're trying to combine that with microbiological studies. So do some patients perhaps respond poorly to some NTM species or some strains of a particular species? A lot of genomes are being sequenced there. And first and foremost, we are working on improving treatment outcomes. Because as I mentioned, outcome of treatment, even in our reference clinic where we think we do the right job, are poor. And that's just not acceptable. We cannot accept that. This should be a treatable disease, like TB is by and large a treatable disease. So that's what we're actively working on, and we're doing a lot of laboratory-based work now, trying to look into the drugs that we currently use. What do they really do? Are the combinations we use really the smartest combinations we can? Because a lot of them have grown from history. we've taken them over from the TB field or other fields. But are they really the smartest combinations? Do we use the right doses? A lot of that is unknown. So we're tackling that from the laboratory perspective. And actually, Beatrice Ferro, who's on the picture here, is one of my PhD students. She's doing that at the moment and doing really, really interesting stuff. So on behalf of our NTM team, I would like to thank you very, very much for allowing me to speak here and be part of this great venue that has really all the people that you want to hear speak. So thanks a lot.